thank you very much, everyone. Glad to see you all here. So the first thing before I get into it is that I think we all understand that the next generation of automotive is very different. There needs to be change. People need to embrace that change. Otherwise, we are not going to get what we're expecting as consumers of automotive products. So that's a key kind of theme that needs to be understood across the automotive industry in our belief. How many people here, raise your hands if you believe you know what the definition of SDV is? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, so I counted like 6 hands. So if I asked random 6 people what the definition of SDV is, I guarantee you I would get 12 different definitions. It's a very difficult concept. There's a lot of intricacy in it. We have actually attempted to try and define this, and I'll show you that now. It's not too wordy. It's more wordy than you would find on a PowerPoint slide, but it's not so wordy that you need to capture all of the different elements in it. But essentially, a software-defined vehicle is a subclass of software-defined systems, which essentially is a development methodology, and this is the important part, which allows you to interdependently between hardware and software, co-develop, co-design, co-validate, such that you can continue to go through your development cycle, understanding how software drives hardware and how hardware can either constrain or enhance or empower software. So the two things are hand in hand. It's no longer valid to go down the route of, I'm going to pick some hardware and I'm going to develop my software to go on that hardware. It doesn't work because the complexity involved in next generation vehicles is too high and it's only ever going to increase. So that's the first key point. Being able to, in parallel, massage hardware, software together, have them interact with each other and understand what the impact of that is. The second key point is to understand that a software-defined vehicle is a bigger, broader system than traditional older generation vehicles. It is a much bigger thing. It has a lot of different interactivity points between other subsystems and components within the vehicle, but not just there. It also has to interact with other vehicles. It has to interact with roadside. It has to interact with services, cloud, all of these other aspects. It is a much bigger system. So when you're going down the route of co-developing in parallel and interdependently developing hardware and software, you also need to cater for the system level requirements and an understanding of that, such that when you massage these different things, you're not violating requirements that were originally in place from the beginning. And I'll show you an example of that in just a minute. The important part there is being aware of the broader system and understanding that that has an input into how you manage the software and hardware in parallel. Ultimately, what you want is an optimal solution that satisfies performance, cost, manufacturability, reliability, safety, amongst other things. So that's a really important point from the get-go. So there are certain requirements that you need to deploy this kind of SDS or software-defined system methodology. We have to give software developers an environment way before silicon is available that is fast enough for them to actually do software development. Traditional ways of doing that relied on things like SystemC and KEMU and other modeling techniques, which are way too slow for software developers to do what it is they do. They want to iteratively debug, change, compile, run all over and over thousands of times a day. And they need to be able to do that on a system that works for them. You need to be able to allow changes to be made, not just to the software, but also to the underlying hardware. So if you make a change in the software, you want to understand that, okay, do I have enough CPU performance to implement that change in software? Do I need more CPU cores? Can I get away with less CPU cores? Do I need a GPU? Do I need an NPU? Do I need all of these questions that come up all the time? Is it better for me to have an NPU or run CPU bound? Those kinds of questions need to be answered. And we need an environment that has the capability to answer those questions. Along with that is actually enabling the exploration and analysis of the hardware software codependencies. So understanding that if I implement a hardware accelerator, that's going to be better for me than running something on a classical NPU or a GPU, for example. And then finally, all of the work that you do down there at potentially SOC or ECU level needs to be reconciled upwards towards the requirements of the overall product at the end of the day. So the only real way to address the increasing complexity of these types of next generation, I was going to say products, not just vehicles, but everything, and to meet consumers' expectations for the demand, for the functionality that they want, because all consumers are now expecting their cars to do what their phones can do, expecting what their cars can do, what their computers can do, what, you know, all these kinds of things. And the turnaround time for a vehicle is way too slow right now for that to happen. Cars are, you know, essentially obsolete when they hit the forecourt. So, you know, we need to speed that up. And at Siemens with PAVE360, that's exactly what we're trying to do, along with AWS, a key partner. So as an example, I give you this. On the right side there, you'll see a typical flow: design, optimize, verify, implement, manufacture, deploy, and maintain. Right? A typical vehicle would go through that process. You'd start by looking at the requirements and then designing, going into design. Now, one of your requirements might be, we need to have a 500-mile range. You then go into designing your product to deliver the 500-mile range, right? You go through the process of optimize, verify, implement, and it gets deployed, and it's out there in the field. And now you decide you want to do an over-the-air update that potentially increases or improves the advanced ADAS functionality, right? Customer purchases that. They get in the car. They start driving. All of a sudden, what you find out is your range goes from 500 to 400 miles. Now customer's not happy. They bought a car that did 500 miles. Now they've got a car that does 400 miles, right? Now, had you gone through the process of trying to understand how the software hardware dependency would change based on a software upgrade of that nature later on, at the very beginning, right there at the design phase, you would know that there were limitations on what you could provide in terms of a software update, and not provide ones that are going to limit or constrain the value of the car, of the product at the end of the day. That is in essence what we're trying to put together within the PAVE360 environment. So something even as simple as that, right, which technically is actually not that hard to do, but has the potential to really, really mess up the value proposition of the product at the end of the day. So it's really got to be catered for at the earliest stages of the design. In terms of an approach to software-defined vehicles, all of the stuff I just talked about really points at trying to explore and understand and find issues as early on in the design cycle as possible. Those subtle interdependencies that you might not be able to see until you get to final product can be modeled and simulated at a very early stage at various levels of fidelity, so that you can get to a point where you're confident that there are things that you can do later on in the cycle that are not going to harm the value proposition of the product. Those difficult and impossible corner cases that require you to put your system through a scenario and actually understand what comes out of that and how you might make some changes to that needs to be done very early on and at multiple fidelities. Ultimately, what we're talking about here is steering away from multiple versions of prototypes, hardware prototypes, and leaving the prototyping, the physical side of what it is you're trying to do, till the very last stages of the development cycle. So what we really need here is a multi-fidelity, mixed fidelity approach to digital twin that can be leveraged early in the design cycle and continue to be leveraged throughout the design cycle in case there are modifications, changes, or even to the point where you're going on to the next generation of product and you want to look back at how this actually panned out, you have that data, you have that that capability to then make those changes to reference. So what are we actually doing? Well, we worked very closely with AWS to develop a very early design prototyping platform, which we call Inexis Architecture Native Acceleration, or ANA for short, A-N-A. We worked with ARM, we worked with AWS to create a platform that optimizes Graviton AWS resources to show software developers a target SOC. What a developer sees on top of this is essentially what we call a virtual SOC or a VSOC that is aligned with as much and closely as possible as the actual target SOC that they're trying to get to. So in this case, take an ARM Cortex-A720 AE, which was launched in March last year. We worked very closely at that point in time with ARM and AWS to launch, almost at the same time as the CPU was launched from ARM, a virtual prototyping environment, so a digital twin environment that allows software developers to create software on that CPU way before any silicon was available. And the way in which we've worked with AWS and in our own internal R&D teams is that we can actually enable this running at real time. So a software developer writing software on this would see no difference in performance as to whether they were running on a real hardware development board. The difference being, it's in the cloud, it's reconfigurable. So going back to the definition, meaning I can change the number of cores, I can change the configuration of the SOC, I can change the way the registers are viewed, all those kinds of things, the device tree, peripherals, all those kinds of things. And I can massage the software, because I'm going to do that anyway. And both of those things can be done in parallel at a very fast speed, iteratively, again and again and again, until I get to a point where I'm happy with my software, I'm happy with my hardware configuration, and I can take the next step. And that next step is then moving on to deeper, higher fidelities, more accuracy, where I'm going to run slower and slower simulations because I need the cycle accuracy to get the performance data that I need to make sure the hardware software is interacting correctly. So this is typically the kind of system that we could implement. So you're looking at the physical hardware, which is essentially the ARM-based server hardware, which we then take an ANA layer, which we've developed, and map these resources onto an ARM Cortex-A with a generic internal controller, memory interface, GPUs, IOs, peripherals, etc. We then layer on top of that multiple operating systems that can then do different functions, and then the applications get written on top of that. And really, the software developer is looking at that very top-level application and middleware. I'm going to design a graphics application on top of an OpenGL or Vulkan framework, and I'm going to run that on an A720 AE with 8 cores in 2 clusters using GPU acceleration, which all of that is capable. It can be done. It's very quick. And I will show you an example. And it's running at gigahertz speeds, right? So as an example, we worked very closely with a major German OEM. They had exactly this problem. They had a started production target, and their silicon was delayed. So no access to silicon. They've got a bunch of servers basically sitting there waiting for hardware so they can start developing the software. They've got a bunch of third-party partners that are waiting for hardware. And there is no way of developing this. I mean, I'm looking around at faces and I'm seeing a lot of nodding heads going, I've seen that problem. I understand that. They came to us and helped them configure an ANA-based virtual SOC, which as closely as possible matched the silicon that they were waiting for. They then used that to get on with their software development. They actually also enabled their third-party partners to use the same system. So now you've got a bunch of developers across multiple locations developing software on an SOC that doesn't yet exist. And that gave them the leg up that they needed to basically say, okay, I've now got most of my software done. The only thing I really need to worry about now is the very low-level drivers that are going to be very specific to the silicon. In terms of the kind of performance that software developers expect, if you look at the bottom there, this project achievements piece, we showed a boot to Linux in 8 seconds, a boot to Android in 3 seconds. Those two in the world of Kimu and other modeling techniques, you're talking about 8-10 minutes. A software engineer is not going to sit there and wait for a system for 10 minutes to boot. They just won't do it. And that was the key thing for this particular German OEM and their partners, is they wanted that speed to be able to iteratively develop the software. The whole system, and this is going to sound a bit more like a product pitch, but I apologize for that, but it's basically a web-based UI. You go in, you can use a lab function to configure your SOC. You then create that, spin that up, you get a console, you get virtual displays, you have the capability to view a bunch of different metrics and things like that through the web-based UI. it's all running on the cloud, on AWS. So if you have an AWS account, it should be fairly simple and easy to spin up. And you can really just get going as quickly as you really need to. Moving further from this, then you also have, starting there on the left side, where you're exploring architectures and configuring your SOC and developing software pre-silicon in that fast environment. Once you have a model that you can use, you then want to start exploring how that works in a system. This is, again, going back to the original definition of trying to be more system aware of what your software is actually going to interact with when it gets out there onto the silicon. Moving forward from that pre-silicon software development, you want to build a system. And at, within PAVE360, we have a PAVE360 backplane, which the ANA model can connect into, to the other end of which you will connect things like Carlo pre-scan simulation scenario generators, MATLAB models, all kinds of other things that you might want to connect up to the system to make sure that the software that's running on your target virtual SOC is responding and behaving and acting in the way that you expect it to, even in the context of the wider system. And all of the metrics that come out of that can also then be explored and analyzed and understood. And again, that can all run on AWS. So in short, we're talking about early pre-hardware, pre-silicon development environments that allow you to explore both hardware-software interdependence as well as in-system dependencies early on in the design cycle so you don't fall into the trap of 500 miles versus 400 miles. We are here at a bunch of different places. If you would like to go and see an actual car that implements this, a real full-size vehicle, we've converted from EV into a completely autonomous vehicle, running PAVE360 at the back end using the system-level backplane that I described. If you want to wander over to the Tata Technologies booth in 4260, it's in the same hall, you can see that. Cognizant has a full simulator, driving simulator, that is also leveraging this technology. And you can get in touch with some of the people from Wipro in the meeting rooms, and they will be able to show you more about what we're doing as well. So thank you very much. Appreciate the time.